Thank you. in his presence there is fullness of joy. At his right hand there are pleasures forevermore. So glad you're here this morning. As we enter into worship, I'm going to invite our Harvest Family prayer ministers to make their way, and they're going to be stationed across the front here. And as we enter into worship, if you have a need in your life, if you need someone to agree with you in prayer over something that happened, we would love to pray with you and believe God for a miracle. Believe God and agree with you in faith for God to move mightily. Can we just set our hearts to worship? Jesus, we're here to worship you, to chase after you, to receive all that you have for us today. We lay aside every distraction, every hurdle that we've had to overcome just to be here. Everything that we're facing right now, the problems and the circumstances that surround us, we refuse to allow any other voice to drown out your voice to us today. We just enter into worship. We love you, Jesus. Come on, let's just worship him. If you have a need, I encourage you to step out and come and receive prayer today.
this morning. I'm Pastor Tommy, Associate Pastor here at Harvest Family. Man, it's just a blessing, again, to have you here this morning. Wow, are you excited this morning? He's great here. Oh, why don't you high five your neighbor and tell him he's great, he's wonderful.
Man, I like it when they crank that up, don't you? I like it loud. Everybody doing good? Before we get into the Word, come on, just hold up your Bible real quick. We got to do this. Shout it out with me. This is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. I can do what it says I can do. Today I'll be taught the Word of God. I boldly confess. My mind is alert. My heart is receptive. I'll never be the same. I'm about to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. I'll never be the same. Never, never, never. I'll never be the same. In Jesus' name, amen. I almost, while we were doing that, looked down and said, and my shoe is untied. I don't want y'all to confess that today. So, how are we doing? Good?
Yeah.
Let me just ask this before we get started. How many of you here today are legitimately college football fans? Let me see hands. Four of you. Yeah, right. We know there's more than that. Okay, now let me answer. Here's another. We're just taking a survey. How many of you actually, you like pro ball more than you do college football? Let me see your hands. Some of you, after Thursday, are rethinking that. But anyway, some of you burned your Texans gear and all that. So anyway, we need to pray for them. But how many of you, you like soccer? Anybody? Over? Anybody? Yeah, got some soccer players here. Good deal. Well, here's the thing about college football. Because it seems like, more so than in pro ball, in college ball, there's always going to be this miracle play that happens. You know what I'm talking about? Like this fluke play. This crazy fluke play that just turns everything upside down. Y'all seen those? You know what I'm talking about? Probably one of the greatest all-time miracle plays in college football. And what's so funny, every year in college football, this highlight seems to show up every year. But in 84, when Doug Flutie for Boston College, in the last seconds of the game, they were down, scrambling around, 30 mile per hour winds, throws the ball. Check out this video real quick if we can.
Throws it down. Caught by Boston College. I don't believe it. It's a touchdown. The Eagles win it.
Unbelievable.
I don't believe it. Fails at the bottom of that pile. Here comes the Boston College team. He threw it into the end zone. There was no time left on the clock. The ball went between two defensive backs in Miami.
Pretty amazing, right? Some of you, I know some of you weren't even born when that happened, but wasn't even alive, but somehow that would show up. But I know some of you are thinking, okay, Pastor, what in the world does that have to do with me and God and Jesus and the Bible, and where are you going with this? But let me just say this, some of you for today, and what does this have to do with us having communion later? For some of you today, you feel like in life, it's like 4th and 20. You feel like you're down. Maybe it seems like in life you're down like 3 scores. And you feel like if I don't get a miracle play, if I don't have a miracle, something that happens, if I don't get a breakthrough, my marriage is going to end. If I don't get a breakthrough, I don't know what I'm going to do financially. You need God, you need God to do something. And some of you kind of look at your life and maybe you've had some mistakes or failures or just trouble and persecution. And you feel like, I don't even know if I can win in life anymore because you feel like you're so far down in there. So let me just lead into this way. So here's this thing called the Lord's Supper. Some people call it the Last Supper, which actually is incorrect. It's not the Last Supper. When we all get to heaven, we're going to have a celebration around the throne of God and at the table with the Lord. And so Jesus said something we need to wrap our minds around as we're living life. In John 16:33, Jesus said this, "I've told you these things," and these things are John 13, 14, 15, 16, and you can take time to read that on your own, but "I've told you these things so that in me," everybody say in him,
amen,
"you may have peace." You will have suffering, trouble in this world. Be courageous. I have overcome the world. Just time out for a second. I don't care what your beliefs are, if where you are standing, your beliefs about God, Jesus, Christianity, even if you're not a Christian, I don't care who you are. I know this about you. You want peace in your life. We all want peace. I know that. And I know as a football fan, you don't care if your team is up 14 points with 2 minutes left. You're not at peace. You want them to run up the score. Y'all know what I'm talking about? And so for some of us here today, if I were to ask you what quality is missing from your life or that you would love to have in a greater measure, and for some of us, you would say peace. And some of us, we've had failures, we've faced trouble, we've gone through some tough circumstances, and you feel like you're not winning in life. But Jesus said, "I have told you these things so that you can have peace." God wants you to have peace. And Jesus, then he says something we don't like. Oh, I know some of you are backing up on that. Well, I'm super spiritual. I love everything that Jesus says. I don't know about that because I know human nature. But Jesus said, and this is something that's not very popular in the Christian world today. But Jesus said, in this world, did he say in this world you might have trouble?
You will.
I wish he would have said you might have trouble. You might miss it. I wish he'd have said that. Actually, I wish he'd have said, as a Christian, every day you're going to get to eat Lucky Charms and ride unicorns. But he didn't say that, did he? He said, you will have trouble. See, there's this myth, this unspoken myth in church that if I go to church and I give and I serve and I pray and I read my Bible, I won't have any trouble. But that's not what Jesus said, church. He's telling this group of people that are the closest to him, the most intimate with him, hey, in this world, you are going to have trouble, real life trouble. And I know some of you didn't need to read that verse to know that because you're facing trouble at work. You're facing trouble at home, in your workplace, or in your finances. But the myth in much of the church world today is, well, the closer I live to Jesus, the less trouble I'll have. But that's not what Jesus taught.
Come on.
Can you imagine being in the original group of the apostles and Jesus said, hey, boys, it's about to get bad for y'all. And then he says this, take heart. Take heart in the midst of the trouble. Take heart because why? I have overcome the world. And I know some of us would look at that and you'd say, well, how's that help me? Because that would be like me walking up to you and saying, guess what? Tomorrow, you're going broke. But tomorrow, I'm getting $1,000. Well, how does that help me? Are you hearing? That's kind of what that can sound like. But what Jesus is telling them this, actually, before he rose from the dead, they didn't totally understand that what Jesus was saying was, I'm going to go to the cross, they're going to murder and crucify me, but I'm going to be raised from the dead, and if those that will believe in me, I'll come and live on the inside of them and give them eternal life, and whatever you face on this planet, it doesn't matter, because through me, you can overcome and will overcome. Yeah. Somebody shout, I am an overcomer. Regardless of what we're facing, we can overcome no matter how much trouble or persecution that we face in this world. And those apostles, every single one of them, gave their lives. Peter was crucified upside down. That's what they faced, and they overcame. Now, Jesus started this thing, the Lord's Supper. Look at Luke 22 and verse 13. And they went and found as he said to them. I tell you this, you're going to find in life whatever he says to you, you're going to find out if that's the way it's going to be. Amen? He keeps his promises. And he said, they made ready the Passover. When the hour was come, he sat down, the 12 apostles with him. He said unto them, with desire, I have desire to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. Thank God he suffered for you. He suffered for me. For I say to you, I will not eat any more thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took the cup and gave thanks and said, take this, divide it among yourselves, for I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come. And he took bread and gave thanks and brake it and gave unto them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. So this is built on 1,400 years of tradition of the Jewish people celebrating that they had come out of slavery in Egypt. And so they're having this Passover, and what Jesus actually does is said, guess what, guys? This Passover is now all about me. I am the Passover lamb that will be slain so that you can be free and come out of slavery of sin. And whenever you do this, I want you to do it in remembrance of me. Now, it's our conviction as a body of believers that I know some churches have communion like the fifth Sunday of every fourth month and have these, you know, and for us as a church, and I'm not saying that we have it right and that we're right and everybody else is wrong, but when we do communion, incidentally, the way we do communion, you don't have to be a member of this church to receive communion in this church. If you're a member of the body of Christ, you're a saved Christian, we want you to receive communion with us today. Because you're washed in the blood of Jesus. And so, what we do, when we receive communion, I don't tack it at the end of a service. We try to make the entire, I believe it's so important and so powerful that we're to remember Jesus that we make the service about communion. And so today we're going to look at some things that this is what we want to do today. We want to remember some things. Number one, and then you can write this down on the back side of your handout that you're given on the way in. I want you to jot these things down so you can take this with you and have this with you. We have a chance to remember his teaching. We have a chance to remember his teaching. Remember me. When you do this supper, as often you do it, I want you to focus on me. And we need to remember him in the middle of whatever you are facing. You have to remember him and start remembering the teachings of Jesus, the words of Jesus. I encourage you, because sometimes it's the last thing you want to do when you're going through hell and hot water is to start reading the words in red. Take the teachings and the words of Jesus and fill up your spirit with the words of Jesus as you're going through trouble, and speak and declare the words of Jesus when you're going through trouble. And you know, the problem is not that we can't remember his teaching. Because we can remember, we can remember his teaching. How do you know we remember what we want to remember? Amen. Ladies are like, you better, husbands, did you hear that? Remember our anniversary. So we remember. Some of y'all here, you could quote movie lines. Now, don't put up the answer until but let me just see if y'all remember some of these movie lines, okay? See if y'all are tracking with me today. Tell me what movie this is from. I'm going to make him an offer he can't refuse. Y'all know you watch that. Don't act holy. You know you watch that. The Godfather. Y'all know that's The Godfather. Okay, for some of you that are super spiritual, let's do a rated G, okay? How about this one? Toto, it doesn't look like we're in Kansas anymore. Yeah. All right, let's see who the real movie buffs are, okay? How about this one? My mama always told me life was like a box of... Yeah, y'all are doing pretty good. Okay, here's this one. Three words. I'll be back. There he is, the big guy right there. Yeah. So, see, we know stuff, don't we? We know stuff, but when it comes to... How about when it comes to Jesus and his teachings? And listen, this is not about earning our salvation. Thank God you're saved and accepted in the Beloved, and you're on your way to heaven. That's wonderful. I'm talking about growing as a believer in Jesus. And when you go through trouble, that now you have some spiritual weapons that when you walk through it, you have the Word. And see, Jesus taught stuff so countercultural and radical. If we would just apply some of his teachings, I mean, how many of you think it would be amazing? How about this one? Jesus said, you've heard it said, you love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. Pray for them who despitefully use you and persecute you. Just pause for a minute. How amazing would this world be if everybody just lived that verse? How amazing! Would it not change your life and change the world? Yes. Just those two verses. See, the teachings of Jesus are not about that we can have great coffee cups and great bumper stickers and a great t-shirt. But if we'll apply his teachings, it really does change us and change the world. How about this one? Jesus said, and this is how I know God's got a sense of humor, but he says, Jesus said, when you look, how can you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye, but you don't notice the telephone pole log in your eye? Now, God, that's pretty hilarious. I think that's pretty hilarious, isn't it? That's a pretty cool visual, isn't it? Oh my goodness, what if we just live that out? Judgmentalism and criticism and looking down our noses at other people in the church would stop. And live in humility and understand that I need God every day. Look at this. How about this one? Jesus said, do unto others what you would have them. And what if we just started living that out? When we left here and went to the restaurant, people weren't nice to us. That we just loved instead. Man. Nobody had ever said, I'm going to try to do my best to live out the teachings of Jesus, ever ended up in a place in life that they regretted.
All right.
Number two, we need to remember his life. Remember his life. Now, I love biographies. I love reading about, you know, great presidents and generals and great men and women of God through history. And biographies are so interesting and compelling when you read about the lives of people and fascinating things that happen. But ultimately, how many people are just flawed people? But when you read about the life of Jesus, wow, what a life. What a life. Because he was more than human flesh. He was the Son of God in flesh. Think about it. Jesus showed compassion to people in the world that the world rejected. Ladies, research it all you want, but the person who came along and lifted up and valued women, Jesus Christ. When you read through the New Testament and you see the apostles that raised the value and said, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. He elevated and valued humanity. Guess what? It was Christians who started the first orphanages. Christians who started the first hospitals. Christians who started the first universities so they could educate people and get the gospel out there. Listen, I know that bad things have been done in the name of Jesus, but that's not on Jesus. So today, we need to pause ourselves and ask this question. Am I becoming more like him? Because when you look at the life of Jesus in Acts 10:38, it says how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth, who went about doing good, healing all who were oppressed of the devil. And then Jesus would come along and say in John 14:12, he would say, the works that I've done, greater than these shall you done. He's inviting and giving us an invitation to walk in this kind of a lifestyle with him. Man, how powerful, how awesome is that? So number three, remember his mission. Number two, remember his life. Number three, remember his mission. Now, I don't know what your normal week looks like. Some of you are like, I don't know when I've had a normal week. And I get that and I understand that. But our normal morning, we like to try to beat our boys out of the bed and make our coffee. We're going to sit down and read our Bibles, and that's how we connect with God. I try to pray throughout the day, but that's first thing in the morning. Get up, make my coffee, sit down, read the Bible, and before we have to get up and get their lunches ready and school stuff ready. You parents live that, don't know what I'm talking about. So we try to beat them up. But that's our mission, to get up, get in the Word, and that's what we try to do. But there are mornings when I stagger in the kitchen, and one thing that our boys love to do is to play Legos. How many know there's sometimes that Legos don't get put up where they should get put up, right? And there's nothing like staggering and you're half awake trying to get to make coffee and you're barefoot. And you step on one of these beautiful pieces of plastic. And y'all remember what Jesus said? Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. With that as a measurement, I think that, you know, I know that I need to grow. I didn't cuss, but wasn't saying hallelujah and praise the Lord. It's funny because this meme sums it up correctly. There are three levels of pain. Pain, excruciating pain, and stepping on a Lego. Right? But that piece of plastic got me totally off my mission. Totally off my mission. Took me off mission. And this piece of plastic, little square plastic, totally got blown up way bigger than what it actually is. And so my question this morning for us is, how many things like a Lego are keeping you out of your mission? How many things are going on that we're allowing that get us off mission and keep us off mission? At the end of the day, it's just a little piece of plastic. Are y'all tracking with me? See, the life of Jesus, how he stayed on mission blows my mind. He had people that hated him. He had people that constantly attacked and criticized him and plotted to kill him. Jesus knows what it's like to be lied on and criticized and beaten down. And the reason the enemy loves to attack us is so he can get us off mission. Because if you ever get on mission and find your true purpose in God, then he knows that you are going to make a difference in this world for the kingdom of God. Can I have a better amen? Jesus never got off mission, no matter what. And here's my question for us today. How are we doing on mission? On mission. Are you and all I'm saying is, you're a follower of Jesus. I'm not asking, are you living your life perfect? But I'm asking you, are you where you need to be in your walk with God? If you're not, today is a great day to get on track and get back on mission. Number four, remember his sacrifice. Remember his sacrifice. Now, I was an expert on parenting until I had kids. Don't you love that? How people are like know-it-alls, but they've never done it? And y'all know having multiples, you know, are not the same as having one or two. But I thought I was an expert. I would see my older friends that had kids, and they would do stuff and make decisions, and sitting over there like a hot shot saying, I don't know if that's good parenting. Dummy. Anyway, when you have kids, you get this. Now, let me just set it up this way. I have a sweet tooth, okay? This is my weakness. What's Pastor Paul's great weakness? What does he struggle with? I love sweets. I really love ice cream. And my wife doesn't. She can take it or leave it. That's not right. Something's wrong with that. She's more of a chocolate-covered strawberries, cupcakes, cake kind of a person. But that's good. I mean, that's good because it kind of keeps us on balance and it maybe helps me from going overboard. But my boys, God help them, have inherited my sweet tooth. And they love ice cream. And so, and here's the thing. You know, let's look at this. How amazing does that look? Does that not look just incredible? There is a God. And then Bluebell will make something that looks like this. Look at the banana pudding ice cream. And I know some of y'all are like, well, they had a recall the other day. You think I care? You're scared? That's fine. Don't buy anything more to me.
my boys, I have to hide it. They're at that age. I have to hide it. And I pull that pine out, and all of a sudden they're like, Dad, you're my best friend. What you doing, Dad? Dad, can I have a bite? And it becomes revolving spoon. You know what I'm talking about? Until the last bite. I know they're my kids. My wife bore me 3 beautiful, healthy sons. I love them. Give my life for them, but I'm not giving my last bite of Bluebell. I said, Dad, can I have the last bite? No. You know what I'm talking about? I mean, man, I know I'm flawed as a parent. Confession is so good for the soul. And we'll sacrifice as parents for our kids, but how many know there's a limit to what we can do? As human beings, there's a limit. But I want you to think about this. Think about Jesus. Jesus laid down his life for you. He gave you his last breath. As he suffered on the cross, he gave you and he gave me. Think about it. He gave his life. He gave his life. He gave his last breath. His in agony. He knew the cost of what sin would cost, and he knew the payment that had to be made, and he made it willingly and freely for you and me. Wow, what a Savior. And he paid that so we could receive him, and he could live in us and walk in us, and it's his desire that we live like him and be like him. And so let me ask you this. Yes, you're saved and born again on your way to heaven. That's wonderful. But as growing as a believer in Jesus, how are you doing? How am I doing in the sacrifice category? Am I dying more to my flesh and my desires and my wants and my needs for his? For others. How are we doing? Am I more selfish or more selfless? And let's just go ahead and go there while we're on the subject. How are you doing on your giving? How are you doing on your giving of money? Don't look at me like that in that tone of voice. I practice what I preach. I've been a giver long before I was ever in ministry. I supported the church, and we still do. But let me just say, if someone were, Jesus said, wherever your heart is, that's where your treasure is. If someone was just to look at your checkbook, look at your income coming in, look at your giving going out, would they just be able to tell just by looking at that and say, you know what, I can tell by this that they're a follower of Jesus? Because you know what? You can make that right today. You can make that right with God today. So you can have his best in your life. And that's why we're all here. Because God sacrificed everything. He didn't tip the world. He gave everything he had for us. And we're here not celebrating a Savior that gave something. We're celebrating a Savior that gave us everything. Gave us everything. Amen? Let's just give God a hand of praise for that. Number five. Remember his resurrection. Remember his resurrection. Now, I grew up watching football, playing football. Y'all know that. And after after Thursday night, I'm reconsidering that. But know some of you, anyway, it was bad. But, you know, at least the Astros are still in the playoffs, right? I know that didn't go good. But anyway, this is not going good. So you know what we need to do in light of all this bad sports stuff going on? Why don't we just reminisce about the days when Houston was the Houston Oilers, and they had a guy number 34, the Tyler Rose, carrying the football. Y'all know who I'm talking about, right? And this is so funny because when I was in like grade school, I don't even know why I did this. It must have been prophetic, because when I went to the shoe store and got some shoes, I bought a Houston Oilers cap. Isn't that crazy? When I was a kid, I think maybe, you know, hey, he's going to pastor a church in Houston one day. But anyway, everybody knows when Earl Campbell played football, you knew the ball was going to him and you couldn't stop him.
Right.
Just watch the kind of stuff that this guy did. Just, I'm a king.
Mm-hmm.
go buy Earl Campbell sausage today, won't you? You just couldn't stop me. Which, we got to talk about the resurrection. The resurrection was not God's trick play. The resurrection was not 4th and 20 where God just backed up and just threw it up in the air, hoping somebody would catch it. The resurrection was where God called Satan out as far back as Genesis 3:15 and said, Satan, I'm going to crush you. I'm going to run this play and you're not going to be able to do anything to stop me. This is what the rest, 5 different times Jesus said before he went. He said, they're going to crucify me, they're going to murder me, but I'm going to rise from the dead. In other words, they are not going to be able. God's going to put the ball in my hands. He's going to put redemption and the hope of the world in the hands of Jesus. And there's nothing that the world, the devil, or anybody else can do to stop what God wants to do. What separates Christianity from every single other philosophy, religion, and belief system in the world. It's the resurrection that you, is because of the resurrection of Jesus, that he was raised from the dead, that you can have hope today. It's because of the resurrection of Jesus that because of the trouble you're going through, you can know you are an overcomer. It's because of the resurrection you can have faith and know that the teachings of Jesus are true. Says, well, all religions of the world are basically the same. I don't think so. No way, Jose. There's been only one risen Savior. Which is why we're finished with this thought. Number 6, remember his commission. His commission was go tell everybody. Go tell everybody. Go tell everybody that I'm raised from the dead. We have a message. Go tell everybody. Now, there's this phenomenon that has hit the world in the last few years called the selfie. How many of you, let's just have some fun, just a survey. How many of you ever have taken a selfie? Let me see your hands. Yeah, yeah. The rest of you are lying. Just kidding. I'm raising my hand. Brooke and I have taken one together. Okay? And so that's cool. Some of y'all are not playing today. I'm upset with you. That's fine. I can look on your Facebook and tell that you've been taking them anyway. And how many of you, let me ask you this, how many of you have ever taken a picture and posted of some food that you're eating? Let me see your hands. Yeah, I've done it. Hey, I was grilling something. I'm like, man, this looks good. I got to post this. They gotta know how good this looks. Just yeah. Anybody else? Yeah. Okay. Get your hands in the air like you just don't care. You know you did it. Yeah. And and how many of you have? And here's the question about selfies. How many selfies did you take before you actually posted them? Like 5, 6, 7. No. Take another. But did y'all know this in Sugarland? There's a selfie statue. Did y'all know that? There's a statue. He's rocking it out. Yeah. Crazy phenomenon in our show. I'm going today, and I post that on Facebook. But let me. Here's another question. And I'm not. How many of you have ever? And I'm not ragging. How many of you have ever run into a celebrity and you made an idiot over yourself trying to get a picture with them, a selfie with them? Yeah, a few less. I know there's some of you out there, you're hiding among us, but that's cool. It's fine. But listen, for some reason in our culture, in our society, that selfies are okay, taking pictures of ourselves and our food and posting it for the world to see. That's okay, acceptable. But what about Jesus and telling others about Jesus? Jesus told us that we make sure that we tell people about a God that loves them. that loves them so much, he came to earth and he gave his life so that he could live in them and they could have abundant life on earth. An eternal life in heaven. Think about it. The reality is there is a hell, and people that don't know him will go there. And that's why this is so important, and you hear us say this a lot at Harvest Family, but found people will find people. When you've been found by God, then we go and find others who need God. Say it with me. Found people, find people. Because everybody in this room has been commissioned by Jesus to reach someone. All of us, God wants us to reach someone. And if we got to take that serious enough that if it's okay, if it's okay to take a picture of my sushi and with a celebrity, then it's okay to share Jesus with other people. Because at the end of the day, Jesus can do a lot more for people than than my sushi and a celebrity can. Amen. And so we need to remember, maybe there's somebody you haven't seen in a while. Maybe there's somebody on your heart. Maybe there's somebody in your sphere or your circle of influence that God wants you to reach out to. Jesus has called us all to reach out and love to people, to lift people and to love people. And so let me just ask you, I'm not asking you, are you perfect? But in our growth and our walk with Christ, where am I? Am I where I need to be? Are my eyes open to those around me? Not just about myself and my needs, but am I looking around in my walk with God to those who really need Jesus? And we'll close with this. And I want the ushers to go ahead and make their way with communion, if you would, guys. But number 7, just jot this down. Remember his promise. Remember his promise. Let's close by looking at this promise together out of John 16. Verse 11, worship team, if you would come as well. But let's look at this, John 16:33 out of the Amplified. I know this is wordy, but I've been talking for the last 30 minutes, so y'all can talk for 30 seconds and read this out loud with me, okay? Ready? Go. I have told you these things so that in me you may have perfect peace and confidence. In the world, you will have tribulation and trials and distress and frustration, but be of good cheer. Take courage, be confident, certain, undaunted, for I have overcome the world. I have deprived it of its power to harm you and to have conquered it for you. How powerful is that promise? And you may be here today and you really need a miracle. You really need a breakthrough. God to come through for you. And worship team, you can go ahead and begin to play whenever you're ready. You may need a comeback. Today is the day for you to remember that God is your playmaker. I said God is your playmaker. And you need, God wants to remind somebody today. Hebrews 13, I love this. Out of Hebrews 13, it says, let your conversation or your lifestyle be without covetousness. Be content with such things as you have. For he has said, I will never leave you, never forsake you. If you would just take that one verse, when depression tries to hit you, when you feel overwhelmed, when you feel defeated, when you feel at your lowest point, it doesn't matter. You have to override feelings and walk by faith that God is who he says he is. That in your darkest moment, where it's the most bleakest moment, God has said, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. This is why the Apostle Paul, who would be in a prison, he wrote many of his writings while he was in a dark prison cell and other believers had abandoned him. He knew God was with him. God was never going to leave him, and he was never going to forsake him in the trouble, in the persecution, no matter how dark it got. And look at this in verse 6. So we can boldly say, the Lord is my helper. The Lord is my helper. I don't know what you're facing today, but you need to know that the Lord is your helper, and you don't have to fear what men will do, because God is your helper. How powerful is that? He's your help. said, you don't have to be a member of this church to receive communion. If you're a member of the body of Christ, as our ushers make their way and the worship team leads us, I want you to, and here in a moment, we're going to receive together. Go ahead, guys, and begin serving as they come around. And we're going to worship. Go ahead and lead us, team.
Receive together and just want to read a portion of Scripture.
Scripture. Paul the Apostle speaking in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23, I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered and shared with you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you, this do in remembrance of me. And after the same manner, he took the cup, and when he had supped, he said, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. Do it, and as oft as you do it, and oft as you drink it, do it in remembrance of me. You may eat and you may drink. Can you just thank him for his blood after you receive? Would you just right where you are in your own way? You have to worship God like me. Just between you and Jesus. Jesus, I thank you for your sacrifice. Lord, we remember your teaching. We remember your life, your mission, your resurrection, your commission. We remember your promises today. We reverence you, we worship you, and we honor you, Lord. Come on, let's just worship him and thank him for his precious blood. We love you, Lord. I'm so thankful for the blood.
Joy, Lord, I receive right now.
Lord,
but there's only going to be one victor of this gift card today. Hey, man, we got a $25 Academy gift card. I want to bless during this series, Game On series. And by the way, the ladies' retreat over the weekend was phenomenal. Some of you ladies were there. Incredible move of God, the power and the presence of God. And yesterday morning, this lady spoke, and I've been getting so much feedback from it. I told her, I think as a part of this Game On series, next Sunday, you need to share this message about the power of the Holy Spirit with us at Harvest Family. And so next week, Pastor Brooke's going to be delivering the Word of God. Don't miss it. But, amen. So during this series, we're going to have a giveaway every week, and you're welcome. Hopefully after the Texans win, you'll feel good about wearing your Texans gear again. But get back on track. But feel free during this, you can wear whatever your team is. Feel free. Just have a good time. All right, I think some of y'all are ready. Okay, here we go. Get your ticket ready. 416-8406. 406. 416-8406. All right, Elmira. Amen. Pastor Tommy, would you come? God bless you. We love you. Hope you have a wonderful week. Hope we get to see you this Wednesday as we continue with the Art of Prayer. Then join us next Sunday, Pastor Brooke, delivering the word. We love you. God bless you.
Amen. Father, we thank you. We love you. We bless you. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your glory. Thank you for our dear pastors and every soul that heard your word. Father, we thank you and we give you praise and glory. In Jesus' name, let the church say amen and amen. Amen.